worship here at First English once again. We welcome you who are visiting us on the YouTube channel and on the radio. Welcome to another day of cold and kind of blistery morning. It is here in November. We are still in our after Pentecost season, but we are fast approaching Advent. So we are excited to begin to start to roll out our ideas, our plans for what that will look like this year. No major announcements besides Pastor Brenda is here with us today, so we are excited to finally welcome her, and I will invite her up to do our confession forgiveness.
The Holy Spirit calls us together as people of God. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Amen. Let us pray. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy One,
we confess that we are not great for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your world of community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our opening hymn is number 688, Lord of Light. Let's sing verses 1 and 4.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. come, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Let us pray. Righteous God, our merciful Master, you own the earth and all its peoples, and you give us all that we have. Inspire us to serve you with justice and wisdom, and prepare us for the joy of the day of your coming. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading for this morning comes from Zephaniah. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice. He has consecrated his guests. At that time, I will search Jerusalem with lamps. I will punish the people who rest complacently on their dregs, those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do harm. Their wealth shall be plundered, and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The warrior cries aloud there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring such distress upon people that they shall walk like the blind. Because they have sinned against the Lord, their blood shall be poured out like dust, and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath. In the fire of his passion, the whole earth shall be consumed. For a full and terrible end he will make of all the inhabitants of the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our second reading comes from 1 Thessalonians. Paul writes, "Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day is to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of the light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for our helmet the hope of salvation, for God has destined us for not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. The words of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went at once and traded them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one with 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the day of joy." Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you are a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours." But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the banks, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him," and he gave it to the one with the 10 talents. "For those who have more will be given, and they have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even though they had what they had was taken away. As for the worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. It may be the most important and the most consequential question ever uttered in the history of humanity in the Bible. Pilate's 3 words, "What is truth?" So if you remember in that dystopian novel, 1984, George Orwell, he coined that term doublethink to describe the phenomenon of rejecting things that we know to be true, or accepting things we know to be false in order to fit in with our peers or our party or our affinity group or our tribe. And now while Orwell was writing fiction, he was revealing a little bit of truth that hits close to home to all of us, at least from time to time. We tell ourselves things that we know aren't true. Now, of course, most of the time, these little fictions that we pass off as truth, they don't come from a place of malice. Actually, quite opposite. We tell ourselves these stories about why one grocery store is better than another, or why one brand of car is superior to that other brand of car, or why our basketball team is the best team in the league, or our football team is better than yours. Now, to some degree, we tell ourselves these things in order to build that sense of identity and of character. But these aren't the only tall tales that we try and trick ourselves into believing. Think about it for a moment. We tell ourselves, one more credit card's not going to bankrupt me. One little office flirtation won't hurt my marriage. Or the big one, God doesn't really love me. Then, before you know it, in the very things in which we've conceived ourselves turn out to be the lies that destroy us. Although we are well acquainted with the phenomenon, here in the 21st century, it's not a new thing. In the days of the prophet that we heard about, Zephaniah, the people of Israel had gotten into the habit of convincing themselves that their perceptions are true, that the facts were false. God doesn't care about us, they said. God is off doing other things. What business is it of God, of how I conduct myself? And what God doesn't know is not going to hurt me. We can't trust God to protect us, they lamented. We've got to take charge and protect ourselves. God's not going to make us happy, they scoffed. But our mansions and our wealth and our power over other people, those things are the things that are going to make us happy. But Zephaniah did what prophets do and spoke a very unwelcome and hard-hitting truth to the people, people who were convinced otherwise. And the voice of God rushes forth hotly from the lips of Zephaniah. I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the people who rest complicitly on their own dregs. Their wealth shall be plundered and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink the wine from them. For the great day of the Lord is near and hastening fast. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord, the day of the Lord's wrath. In the fire of his passion, and the whole earth shall be consumed. For a terrible end he will make of all of the inhabitants of the earth. So at the very core of Zephaniah's prophetic poetry, it is that message so shockingly clear that it all but slaps us in the face. The people of this Zephaniah's day thought that God was a relic, that it was a bygone era, and whose supremacy had once been everything, had now eclipsed to their attainment of human knowledge and those things that they knew for themselves. Those who lived in Zephaniah's day considered themselves free to do whatever they wanted and to act how they pleased, looking out chiefly for themselves, and then, and only then, maybe, just maybe, if they got around to it, and they might consider doing something great for someone else, because it would make them feel good. Does it sound familiar? Zephaniah's proclamation of the truth of the people of the day and of our own have exchanged for a lie, life that is beyond our control. And the more that we try to control it, the more uncontrollable it becomes. So an oil refinery explodes halfway around the world. We read about the environmental costs and the billions and billions of dollars paid to restore it, to make reparations. But we don't know anybody who knows anybody who works for them. So it's not really our problem, is it? Right? We've got everything sorted out in our well-managed, well-controlled lives, right? But then we realize that the fish that we're feeding our family comes from that region. Oils and toxins seep into the rock bed and pollute the streams and rivers and growing fields hundreds of thousands of miles away, where the produce that stocked our refrigerators is grown. The retirement plan that we are enrolled in, trying to secure our future, is heavily invested in that company. Remember when the United Kingdom, when they voted to withdraw from the European Union, Brexit, we called it. Okay, that's their choice. That's how they're gonna live out their lives, that's how they're going to work things, but how's it going to affect us? The Eurozone is the second largest buyer of the US Treasury bonds. Not to mention the hundreds of things that are imported and exported from the US. What affects their economy today will affect ours tomorrow. The more we try and get ourselves used to into believing that we have it all figured out, the deeper truth comes out where the facts are laid bare. But hold on a second. Zephaniah is this tiny three-chapter minor prophet wedged in at the end of the Hebrew Bible. In our entire three-year lectionary cycle, we hear readings from it three times. Most of us probably can't remember even hearing, or let's face it, preaching a sermon on this. So can he really be that important at all? Well, turns out Jesus was a preacher after Zephaniah's own heart. He tells a parable about the slaves who were given gifts of different amounts. And although we are quick to equate those so-called talents with money, the parable could easily have been speaking about kindness and creativity or even generosity. The slaves who had taken their gifts and used them offered others for creative and elaborated on much needed blessing in the world around them. They are rewarded when their master returns. But the one who takes what has been given to him and hoards it up only for himself is he concerned. If we can find a way to sort through all of the advertising and the marketing and the perception, when we arrive at the truth that both Zephaniah and Jesus are desperately trying to tell us, our vocation is not to try to be in control of the universe. No, our vocation as followers of God, we must meet in Jesus and to share the abundance of grace and mercy and love that has been entrusted to us, to each and every one of us. We are commanded to plant seeds of generosity, knowing full well that we may never see a return on our investment. We are commanded to show kindness to people who don't deserve it. We are commanded to love those who at their hardest try to be unlovable and forgive those who have gone out of their way to be unforgivable. The day of the Lord that Zephaniah and Jesus proclaim does not have to be a doom and gloom, end of the world scenario. For those who receive their God-given gifts with humility and then go and share them with the world, the day of the Lord, the day of the Lord of rejoicing, a day when our world has long been turned upside down by greed and oppression and hate, then it will be set right by peace and justice and love. So the question is, what will we do with all that has been given to us? Will we keep it locked up and hidden away under our bed or dug in the backyard? Or will we take a risk and open our hearts and share it openly and freely and radically with the world? Amen.
Our hymn of the day is number 678, God Whose Giving Knows No End.
The words of our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all those in need. Lord of the church, ignite your people with the passion of your love. By the fire of your Holy Spirit, unify us across ministries, congregations, and denominations, and refine us to participate in your activity throughout the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of creation, we stand in awe at the works of your hands and praise you for the beauty of our natural hills and our beautiful sunsets. Bless the earth of your glory and restore its integrity where exploitation has caused ruin. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of the nations, sound forth your justice in the ears of all leaders. Increase concern for those who are most vulnerable, especially as international leaders forge trade agreements and cooperate to end human rights abuses. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of all in need, search out all who cry to you in distress. Scatter the heavy clouds of depression, chronic illness, unemployment, and loneliness. with your radiant light. Send us as encouragement and signs of your healing. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of the stranger, stir up holy restlessness in us to extend love to those at the margins. Release our desire for control and open us to learn from the perspectives of others. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of the living and the dead, we give thanks for all the saints at rest from their labors. Rouse us to live by their example, that saints yet to come may also know your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen. As we head into the meal portion of our liturgy today, we ask that you go ahead and start gathering up your materials, whatever wine or grape juice or bread that you have, and get ready for communion.
Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that we may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection open to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come to the banquet table, where Christ gives himself as food and drink.
The blood of Christ.
Okay. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to all the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our sending hymn is number 674. Let us talents and tongues employ.
Of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit be with you all.